I teach here in sociology and anthropology. And I started giving these workshops in 2008 when I was a new professor at Laurentian University and really recognizing that the students I was working with there didn't have any of the support that I had had when I was a grad student. So when I was a grad student, we had the University of California paid to have this incredible woman, Dorothy Duff Brown, come and give workshops on writing. And I was also teaching as a writing professor there in the undergrad program, thinking a lot about writing. And so this is sort of my attempt to synthesize and offer some of what I've learned from a long time of struggling with my own writing process, having a lot of friends who struggle also, and doing a lot of kind of reading in this weird genre of self-help, academic self-help books. And also I had a brief stint in looking at sort of like the bourgeois capitalist productivity genre of self-help. So this is what I'm bringing. The title of this workshop, Suffering Free Academic Writing, is a riff on the Buddhist claim that pain is inevitable, but suffering is optional. And so the logic here, in the Buddhist context, it's that we're all going to die, things are going to change, this is hard, and we have to work with that. But that normally we layer on a lot of different narratives, habits, various things to try to avoid the fundamental pain of existence. In the writing context, I think it's fair to say, and it's correct to say, and I think all of you know, based on what you just talked about, you have really beautiful insight into what you're experiencing and what you need. So that's one thing to just recognize. I think that none of the things that we experience as our particular pains in writing are going to go away completely. I think we're always going to have a hard time with writing, because I think in ways that I'm going to talk about, writing is just hard. But normally, partly because of, you know, I don't have a complete diagnosis, but some pathologies and bad habits and ways of being in academia that we receive from our supervisors and mentors and that are passed on, and that, you know, sometimes I feel myself as a supervisor passing on to my students. Sorry, Sarah. There are all these things that actually layer whole other level of shit on top of the fundamental pain of writing. And some of the really typical layers include a particular kind of perfectionism, which I'll talk more about. So a sense that this thing that you're doing, this thesis, is the scope and encompasses all that you are in the world. And so if you don't get this right, you're not going to be loved. A particular set of conceits and understandings about what it means to be smart. So the conception of the solitary suffering genius who has endless time to work on their stuff and is seized by inspiration and able to do anything. And just also the kind of like really petty everyday things that we put on top of the basic difficulty of writing that make it much, much harder, which can be things from playing online chess to forms of talk to ourselves about how we're never going to get this done and we probably shouldn't do a degree anyway and we're not smart enough and someone will soon find out. So all of that and a lot more is what I'm classifying as suffering. And all of that is what I'm saying I don't think we need to have in our writing process. So that's what we're going to be trying to work through today. What it means to recognize that writing is painful, but in some real practical way not increase the suffering associated with that pain. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay. So, and this, these slides are all on my website under the writing workshop link, so you can always find them. They're not that useful. So here's the plan for today. I want to start by talking about attitudes toward the writing process. Then we'll do a few sort of reflections on some useful exercises and why we would think about them. I want to talk about the difference between time management and guilt management and offer some really practical structures for managing what I think is the real problem, which is guilt and all of the affiliated feelings that come along with it. I am going to be asking you to make some really practical decisions about your thesis. So just a heads up that during this workshop, if you don't already have one, you're going to come up with a title, number of chapters, a table of contents, a page limit, and a couple of other things. So don't worry, that'll be just something that we do. Already people look so scared. I'm going to talk a little bit about organizing the sort of material realities of this. Not a huge amount on what it means to write well. That's another workshop, but a little tiny bit on that. And then I want us to really think together about how we can communicate well with advisors and committees. So sometimes this is called managing from below, but thinking about what it means to really use the resources that we have well, both our formal resources in terms of committees and also more informal networks of people that are our peers and comrades. And then we'll talk about knowing when to stop writing, which will coincidentally also be the end of the workshop. Okay. So the first thing is that we know that in academia, we're in a context in which the fundamental structures make us doubt the possibility or the claim that we're fundamentally good, smart, worthy people. We're in the situation where I think people mark defensively when they're teachers teaching undergrads, and there's some sense that we're in competition and a possibility that we might not be smart. Do you recognize this? So the first thing to do when you're starting writing or thinking about writing is to, and this is like, it's so cheesy, and it is not only because I lived in California for 6 years that I say the things that I do about this. I think that we really need to consciously and in a felt way have a view of ourselves as fundamentally and without reference to our academic work, worthy people. People who have dignity, who can stand up straight, who can feel love for ourselves. That we need to, as much as we can, just lay down the idea that we're lacking as fundamental quality of our being, and take up this idea that we are fundamentally enough. And I think that, oddly, this is a really important piece about writing. So we need to have a conception of ourselves as fundamentally good, basically good, smart, curious, interested people. And this is pushing against a way of thinking about ourselves as already accomplished. So we want to be crafting an attitude toward ourselves and our writing that takes it that we are the kind of people who are resilient in the face of setback, who when we encounter something that is not easy, or we fail at something that we were trying to do, that we're hard workers who are able to receive that and then move on. I'll talk more about this when I'm talking about the question of depression in academic work. But the basic idea is that we're trying really hard to formulate a kind of attitude and practice that enables us to keep going in the face of things being hard. So this doesn't include pretending that we don't fuck up or sabotage ourselves. So we can also have an attitude toward that. We recognize, like all of you, when you're talking about the things that you would like to take out of this, recognize the ways that you're not totally functional in relation to your writing, right? And so that's also just a piece of what's happening. So that's a sense of how you approach yourself, how you think about yourself. And maybe one way to say that is just that you refuse imposter syndrome. Is everyone familiar with that concept of imposter syndrome? So you refuse the possibility. You say, no, I deserve to be doing this degree. I can do it. I am good enough to do it. Then you also take an attitude toward the thing that you're writing. So you can be starting to see the thesis or the dissertation as a whole thing. So the thesis or dissertation, how about I just call it the thesis, and everyone who's writing a dissertation can know. So the thesis is a bigger thing, usually, than you've written before. And it's got lots of different parts, right? One way that's very usable to understand what's happening with the thesis is to say, it's a whole thing that I'm making an argument about. But you don't yet know what it's going to be, right? Wherever you are in the process, especially if you're just at the beginning. So you want to be understanding it as a serious experiment. And what that means is that you take it seriously, right? You're doing yourself the courtesy of respecting the work that you're doing. And you're also looking at the work as something you're trying out. So the experiment part of it means that you make definitive tries. You can make choices now. And also recognize when the choices you're making, the tries you're making, haven't worked. So the sense of the thesis as a whole is you conceptualize what the whole project is, you try that out, you see, like, how does this chapter work, right? Is this chapter actually three chapters? So seeing it as a whole doesn't mean that it's fixed, but it means that you have this sense of what's the arc of what you're trying to accomplish. And you try to think about that early so that you're working on this, you know, sometimes for years, but you have a sense of what you're working toward. So this really is one of the only times in your life as an academic where someone just says, go write something and come talk to me when you're done. And there's no guidance necessarily about how to tell when you're done, how long it should be. That's, none of that's given explicitly. So even in order to see something as a whole or as a serious experiment, we have to have some sense of what we're imagining is possible. The next thing is attitudinally that the thesis is something that you are doing. It matters to you, you care about it, but it does not encompass everything you are. So you don't have to do everything in the thesis. And if the thesis is going badly, it doesn't necessarily have to mean that your life is going badly. And it doesn't have to be everything you're doing. So the thesis can be something that is located kind of a little bit away from you, even though it's very closely connected to you. And a piece of that is that it's also something that you don't have to defer decisions on. So you can make decisions about the thesis now, and today we're going to. But one of the patterns is to say, I can't work on that now, or I'm not going to be able to think about that now. I'll think about that later. And so we can actually shift that and say, this is the kind of thing that, because nothing has to be final, but things do have to be done, I can make decisions about. Any questions about that? Or comments about the attitude things? How many people are finding this very cheesy? How many people are finding it very cheesy but curiously reassuring? All right. So this is now just thinking a little bit more about the writing piece. So we need to think about writing as something that is simultaneously very personal and strangely public. So it's vulnerable, and yet the only reason that we're doing it is because we want to put something outside of us in a way that could be workable. So it's just, we can recognize that and use that, understand that. And the balance here is that when we're writing, we can recognize that we're making a claim that matters to us in some way, and we cannot be embarrassed about that, right? So that means that's the piece that is writing sincerely. And in my experience, anyone who's doing work at this level needs to have some sense that they actually are sincere about what they're working on. Because if you don't have some level of sincerity, it's just not actually clear that you should be doing this. Where sincerity here also means interest, right? That you actually want to do it. So we have to be real and recognize that doing a degree is not necessary. Doing a graduate degree is not necessary. No one has to do this. If you're doing this, there has to be some way that you actually want to do it on some level, right? So that's the sincere part. And that's the vulnerable part. You care for it, right? But the part where it's a public thing that's outside of you that you can be working on is that it's also something that doesn't encompass you, and so you can have advice, you can bring in thoughts, people can tell you things about how the writing is going. So you can relocate the writing outside of you. And my analogy for this is my friend Scout, who's a really accomplished mechanic and a beautiful cultural theorist, would have this quality when she was helping me figure out how to fix my car. I would feel like the car was like nothing was ever going to go right again, and I might as well just junk it. And she would have this quality of like, well, no, maybe it just needs to have the brake pads replaced, you know? So this quality of like locating the car as something that could be collectively worked on, right? By me, not a very good mechanic, and Scout, a very good mechanic, with tools, right? So we can think about the writing as something that we can similarly locate outside of ourselves, such that when someone says, so I see what you're trying to do here, and I think it would work better if you did this, that when they're making that kind of alteration, it doesn't feel like they're like moving your lower intestine around, right? Because they've ripped open your belly and they're just gutting around in your innards.
If you like it.
But instead, you can be having this quality of, we're together working on this thing. Does that make sense? So it's locating the writing as something that's available for work. And then when your peers or when your committee gives you commentary on it, it can have a little bit less of that, like, sorry, everyone got really grossed out about the guts, but it can have less of that quality, right? Okay, so the activity here, or the practice, is what one of the people that I think is very useful on this in a book called Advice for New Faculty Members, which is geared toward faculty, but which I recommend to grad students, Robert Boyce, and I'm going to show you some graphs from him, which I find very compelling and useful because I am not someone who is able to make graphs, and so I just love the possibility of graphs. He calls this writing mindfully with moderation. So I have four graphs that I'm going to show you. All right. So this is what he calls hypomania. And this is this quality of when we write, how we think about what the writing should be. So hypomania is that tendency to write fast, with incredible enthusiasm and passion, until you're completely tired out, you're drained, you can't possibly write anymore. It's the romantic. It's the quality of, it's like the conception of being Lord Byron and just like pouring it all on the page, leaving nothing on the field, you know, peeling yourself out of your desk. It's the, I knew someone in grad school who would always show up for a seminar on the days that he was presenting with this kind of stubble that was like, I just have been working so hard, I couldn't possibly shave, right? So that's the sort of hypomania quality. And this is the animating logic to when we say, I can't write my thesis because I don't have enough time. I need at least a full day in order to write anything. So hypomania produces these things. So Robert Boyce studies academic writers. He's a psychologist who does this, and he just sits and looks at them. And in this book, one of the things that he tries to do is talk about what he calls exemplars, so people who write a lot, who write easily, who have a good time writing, who are good citizens of their departments, all the kinds of things that we want to be as academics of whatever scale. So here are the differences between what he calls romantics and moderates. So the romantics are the dark thing. So this is, maybe, should I close the door? Is everyone feeling, okay. So romantics write fast. They're very euphoric. They're excited when they're writing. They feel passionate about it. They're like, so many things to say. They don't have any particular plan. They're just like, I'm just gonna get in there and write about whatever I'm writing about, figure it out. And they make lots of errors in comparison with the moderates. Okay, so does everyone recognize that as a tendency? All right, so the other thing that moderates tend to do is binge. So, or that romantics tend to do. So this is binges per month. So romantics have many more binges. They have about the same number of brief daily sessions of writing, which we'll talk more about, as moderates. And this is the one that I think really is like kind of amazing. So here is the romantic. This is how many pages they wrote. this is how many pages the moderates wrote in a month. So just, isn't that interesting? And so obvious because it's a graph. And then this one is equally important, but also very interesting. Manuscripts finished and submitted per year, right? So the romantics are like here, and the moderates are like here. So you see there's also like many more pages got written, right? The proportion of pages is much higher than the proportion of manuscripts. But the proportion of manuscripts submitted is still much higher in the moderates than in the romantics. Okay, so another graph. I don't know how you measured this, but this is supposed to be the measurement of creativity. So that romantics feel very creative. They feel like they're the epitome of creativity. But according to Boyce, the moderates actually had many more new, interesting ideas. And final graph, which I think is very important, because one of the things that we also know is that grad school is a time when people experience tremendous stress, depression, and harm, right? That grad school actually hurts us. So if we're gonna really think about that, and I think we need to take that seriously, right? We need to say, we want to and we need to resist the possibility that we're gonna go along with the normalization of academia as a place where people are harming ourselves just to be here, right? Like that should be something that we don't accept. And that means that we should have good supports, right, for ourselves in the school process. It means that we shouldn't say, oh yeah, you're having a really hard time, that's just a normal part of grad school, right? There's all these things that we can really take seriously. And a piece of it that I found so interesting in this book, and that really resonates for me with the way that I've experienced and think about how people experience this, is the place of writing in depression. So just check this out. So again, romantics and moderates. So romantics pre-writing are more depressed. And let's again just imagine that he actually has a good metric for measuring depression. I'm not sure that he totally does. Because again, qualitative researcher, not very good at understanding. Should be better understanding. So moderates are less depressed in general, right? Before writing, they feel a little bit less depressed. After writing, you see that the romantic's depression goes down a tiny bit, right? The moderate's depression stays about the same. This is what I think is so interesting. One day after writing, the moderate's depression is down a little bit more, and the romantic's depression is up. And 2 days after writing, it's up really even higher. So if we believe this, what this means is that if we take a romantic approach to our writing, what we're doing is dramatically increasing our depression, our stress, our sense of panic, our feeling that things cannot possibly go right. Does this resonate, or do you believe the graph? And then if that's actually what's happening, which in my experience talking to people, looking at people, and in some of my own writing practices, it's so much harder to write, to start writing, when you're this day depressed. Right? So that really makes us feel like, I think, makes me feel like we need to work with this. So in order to get from this place where we think that the good thing to do is to wait until we're totally inspired, we have a driving thing that we need to say, and we need to have as many hours as possible, and we're not going to eat or shave or drink anything, or if we drink anything, it's just going to be coffee and then a little switch to port when it's later, then we need to sort of think about, why are we doing that? How would we actually change that pattern? Because it's very deep, right? It's like, you see it happening, it starts way before we're undergrads, even, these patterns. So this is sort of the beginning piece of time and guilt management, and then we'll take a break and I'll tell you, we'll go into sort of the things that I think are really the most central. The first piece is just having the sense that what we need to manage is less time and more guilt. We need to have less guilt, and that will give us more time. So guilt management here means recognizing that we're not going to get everything done, and that everything we're going to do is at the expense of something else that we're not going to do. So in the self-helpy book, The Power of the Positive No, the way the dude says this is, every yes that you say is a no that you're saying to something else. But another way to say that is, we can forgive ourselves for not getting everything done, because it's not possible. And then we have to forgive ourselves for making choices about what we're going to get done, because that's just the world, like that's just the situation that we're in. So this means recognizing that not everything is as important as everything else. And that means saying that when you're choosing what you're going to do, having a kind of clear idea that you are choosing what's more important than something else. So this could mean for the duration of this project, which is not going to be 10 years, right? Finishing the thesis is more important than dating. Or laundry. Or sweeping. You could be saying, spending time with my kid is more important than writing a good thesis. I'm going to write an okay thesis so that I can have time to be with my lover. It is more important to me to write the thesis than to be the best teaching assistant I can be. Or it's more important for me to do a really good job TAing, and I really need to exercise, and I am on purpose not working on my thesis this week. So I'm just trying to say, one way to do this is to say, I'm making decisions about what I do. And so this comes back to that kind of attitudinal thing, where on some level you recognize that the things that you're doing are things that you chose to do. So this sounds a little bit harsh, but I mean it to be nourishing, actually, that no one has to be in grad school. It's not a necessary thing. And so there's things that you have to do if you want to be in grad school that are horrible. There are several people here who are doing undergrad degrees. But there's something that actually works when you say, I'm actually choosing this, and so I'm choosing not to do other kinds of things. And so then how am I going to relate with this particular thing that I need to get through? Any questions or comments or worries about that claim? You were just moving, okay. Dangerous. All right. So one of the things that I think,
I was going to ask a question. This goes back a little bit to the attitudinal thing.
Yeah.
So did you find to yourself with imposter syndrome or were like fear and doubt and so forth, like just reminding yourself that like confidence growth, like reminding yourself you belong, I think, have made it here for a reason. Is that kind of the reassuring attitudinal thing, or what did you find helped get through?
So one thing that helped me was to have this sense, some partially an external referent, right? So to say, if I actually respect the people that I'm working with, like if I trust my supervisor and my committee and my teachers, then I have to trust them enough to have the belief that they wanted me to be here, right? But then what really worked for me was to have this sense, and like really to like narrate this, that it doesn't actually matter what they think. I still have a right to be here. And it also helped me to have a sense that like everyone has imposter syndrome. That everyone who's not like a really functioning and probably pretty nice psychopath feels like they shouldn't be here, you know? So then it's just a logical impossibility for everyone to be an imposter. And I guess the last thing that helped me was to have a sense that it serves the power structures of academia well for grad students in particular to feel subservient, not as good as other people, in competition with each other, worried, needing external affirmation, right? That fosters a particular kind of dependency that is of benefit to slightly egomaniacal professors, as nice as we are as people. And so then the anger, my anger about the structure of academia, especially right now in a moment, like I feel that all of you should really cultivate this sense that, like, if you're in a department that is graduating 50% of the people that enroll and that finds academic jobs for 50% of the people that graduate and thinks that that's good, we can recognize that the system is not okay, right? And it wants to have an army of adjunct professors who on some level believe that this was a meritocracy, and the reason that they didn't get a tenure track job is because they couldn't hack it. And this is not true. So when we resist the imposter syndrome, actually that's, we're resisting all of that. And I think that's absolutely necessary right now. Does that make sense? How to transition out of that? Okay, so to be a moderate is to say that you're on some level recognizing, and this is just, you know, they find this in office office jobs, that most of the time people aren't working, right? That, and if you've ever worked at an office job, it's like you actually only need an hour to get 8 hours. It turns out that this is also true in our jobs, where your writing is part of your job. So that there's only a little bit of the time when you're writing that you're actually writing. And a lot more of that time is what I'm calling suffering. So this is what they call the 80-20 rule. You can look it up. There's lots of self-helpy corporate books about this. But the idea here is that you get 80% of the work done in 20% of the time that you're working. And so what you want to do is have that 20% of the time happen at the beginning of the day, so that you can go to the park for the rest of the day when you could have been suffering, and instead now you're going to be relaxing. So what does that look like? One thing is, so I'm going to argue that this brief daily sessions and what I recommend as units will help this. But a way to cultivate that is this contrast between the to-do list and the will-do list. So the to-do list is a very big and general and vague and kind of endlessly circling thing that takes various kinds of forms. I'm sure you all have different kinds of to-do lists. But a sort of stock characteristic of the to-do list is that you don't ever think that you're actually going to get everything done on it. Or certainly you're not going to get everything done on it today. And usually you don't have a really clear sense of even how long it would take you to do everything on the to-do list. Right, so if you have something on your to-do list, like I have finished chapter 3, right? That's just basically a recipe for feeling like I am a huge failure. Because what does finish chapter 3 actually look like? So the will-do list is a list of things that you actually are going to do. And in order to know that you're going to do them, you have to know how long it's going to take to do them. And in order to know how long it's going to take to do something, you have to have a really pretty clear sense of what the thing is that you're doing. So I'm going to talk more about this in doing project plans and workflow charts. But the sense here is that in order to capture the possibility of getting things done more efficiently, so that you're not always only doing your dissertation or your thesis, you want to be able to have a clear sense of what the things are that you're actually doing. And so it's very useful to have a will-do list for any given day, where you actually cross everything off that list in the day, and where it doesn't matter what order you do them in, because you're going to get them all done. So this is one way of thinking about time and guilt management. Okay, last thing before we take a little break is this point about using the things that we know about our own neuroses as to our advantage, right, as things that we can use. So all of us have our own particular style of little thingy that we do. But there are some generalizable things that we can know about ourselves. Or most of us probably have some of these characteristics. So people who are doing theses tend to be perfectionists. There's different kinds of ways to be a perfectionist, but we tend to be people who have a hard time feeling like something is good enough or done enough. We tend also then to procrastinate. So because the thing that we're needing to do has taken on sort of more weight, right? It's taken on more emotional stickiness than it actually has in itself. It becomes something that's scary to do. So that's the work of perfectionism, right? We elevate the thing that we're working on, so a chapter or a thesis, into something that's much harder than just writing some things about something that you know a lot about and you're interested in, right? It becomes all these other things. And then because that's very hard to work with, you do anything else than working on that, which is procrastinating. So one of the images from a book called The Now Habit that I've talked about, so people who have been in these workshops before, I find it useful, is an image of taking something like walking across one of these tables. You know, so these tables are like pretty big, and if the tabletop was just on the ground, I think none of us would feel any anxiety about me walking across it, right? Even if it was like 30 feet long, would anyone feel any anxiety? But if I start walking on the table height up and down here, I won't actually do it in case anyone really would get anxious, does the anxiety level go up a little bit? So what if we put, you know, this length of stuff, 30 feet, not very long, and we elevate it between two windows, between 100-story tall buildings. And it's the same width, but it's between these two buildings. How many people feel now a little bit nervous at the thought of walking across that? Why do you feel nervous? Very strong. It's not going to bend. Very strong. Why do you feel nervous?
Because I'm a klutz.
Because klutz?
Stakes are higher.
Stakes are higher because death, right?
Yeah.
So the view is that when we take a particular kind of attitude toward our thesis, it's like taking the plank from the ground and elevating it between the buildings. So we raise the stakes. It becomes like, am I a good person? Am I worth walking on this earth? Did all of the sacrifices that I've made or my parents have made to get me to school, am I worth those sacrifices? Right? That's all the stuff that elevates the plank. And so that's perfectionism. And then procrastination increases the intensity that makes us have to do something in relation to that. So procrastinating, waiting until the very last minute before something's due, is like lighting the building that you're standing in on fire. So you have to go across the plank. Does everyone feel that? Or there's a little baby that's just like, doo-doo-doo. You know, it's like gotten to that age where it can like, it's mobile and it sings a little bit while it walks. And it's like, and then you go to the baby, right? Even though it's across the, so that's procrastination doing its work for you. It's metaphorically, it's creating a fire in the building that you're in, or a baby on the other side that's about to die, and then you have to write the chapter. So this is a thing that we can know about our own neurosis. And then we can start shifting that a little bit. So we want to be able to have either really good, strong safety nets. Right, like if you imagine that there's a safety net a foot below that plank, totally gonna catch the baby, your anxiety goes down, right? Or you just bring the plank down a couple of flights and there's a safety net. Or you have a rail that you're hanging onto, or you're strapped into something that's gonna catch you, right? So we can have some of these kinds of things for our writing process. And I'm just gonna suggest a few of them. One is that if we have a particular pattern of procrastination that involves, for example, going to certain websites obsessively, you can pay $5 and get a copy of Antisocial, or there are various other programs that do this. And then you only need to have enough self-discipline to just turn Antisocial on right? You don't have to have the self-discipline to not go to those websites. You just have to have the discipline to turn it on, which only takes a little bit of self-discipline. And then you're not able to turn your computer off or take that program off or reset it. It just frees you from that particular loop. So this is actually like lowering the, turning down the heat, putting a safety net. Other kinds of things that work like this that are technical are things like setting up deadlines with other people who are lower stakes people that you hold each other to. So your committee, your supervisor might be a very 100 floor kind of window. But your housemate or your classmate might be more like a 1 foot off the ground reader. But if they actually are someone that commits to you, they can be someone that is like, no, you need to get me whatever you have. And that can be just scary enough, right? So whatever the particular style is, and I don't know everyone's styles, but the view is you want to think about, you want to ask yourself this question. What is the thing that I could do that would put out the fire, save the baby, and put a safety net under this plank? And just the way that you can set up Antisocial to not let you go to the website, you can start setting some of those things in practice based on what you know about yourself. Does anyone want to try one or share anything or ask anything about that? Yeah.
Phone for me is bad. I'll start writing and then I'll be like, I'm just going to text this person real quick or call this person. I'll just be quick and then totally take my mind away from what I'm trying to focus on.
Yeah. So certainly any kind of push notification should be off, right? So what might you do with your phone?
Turn it off.
Yeah, so like I lived in an apartment where there was a Ziploc bag that hung out the window across, and the TV remote would be in the bag. Sometimes the TV remote would, so totally it's a thing that you could do. Waterproof, difficult to get it back inside. Yeah.
Working places where there's no internet, raw sugar is really good.
Yeah.
Then you're not tempted to do anything, so.
Yeah. Going to raw sugar. Yeah. Places without internet. Yeah.
I keep files where I can throw junk. I can write whatever I want to write, and I know that I can put some results after without actually like throwing it away.
Yeah.
Maybe use it later, although I've never actually used it.
Right. Yeah, so it's a kind of, it allows you to write, if you have this file that you say, this is a junk file, you can write whatever you want, and you don't have to worry that it's good. It can just go there.
Right.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Yeah, I have an example of not helpful.
Not helpful.
Because I've taken this to the extreme. I'm the portrait artist, so I've gone to the woods with a typewriter and tried to do, and then realized after an hour of writing that I've just written a work of short fiction instead of what I was trying to do. So, all that to say, sometimes I wonder if what safety net would actually prevent me from writing, or would actually make me walk across the plank instead of just making up planks and walking over all the planks. Just being a plank walker.
Nothing, you don't have anything that's worked for you?
I've broken everything I've tried to ship. So then I just go back to like self-discipline.
Right. Self-discipline, yeah. And I mean, I've been, there was a study that came out a little while ago that self-discipline was a finite resource that we needed to not waste. Which is, I was like, yeah, that totally makes sense. And that's why the antisocial thing is so useful. And then another study came out that said, no, self-discipline is something that we can actually build and increase. We can get more of it, get stronger in it. So I guess what I want to say is I am a big fan of not having a single final thing that fixes everything, but instead having incremental practices that gradually shift us toward a kind of easier way of being. Because having the big final thing that solves everything is basically a romantic view. So having small, incremental, bit-by-bit things is basically a moderate view, which you're going to find irritating because you're a romantic. So basically, we're just going to undergo, you're going to undergo a total self-transformation. Because reasons that I don't know. But you want to, right? Like if you want to finish, if you want to finish your MA, you want to actually.
I was just thinking of sort of, based on one of the examples you gave, and sort of differences of neuroses. So for me, if I went to raw sugar, I would probably end up sitting there sipping a chai and people watching for 3 hours not doing anything.
Yeah.
So for me, it's really important. Environment is really key. So I can't really do any work on campus either. So working, you know, at home in a space that is just my office space and is really important. And also because of that allows me to close the door.
Yeah.
I think that's a huge problem for me, at least, is that I need to actually physically be able to walk away from a space that is work as opposed to
not work.
Yeah. So that I can, you know, live in my home and not think that I'm supposed to be working or something.
Yeah.
I think it's just interesting how people are.
Yeah, and this is why I don't think there's any final answer, right, to everyone. But that actually we know ourselves better than anyone knows us. So on some level we know what we need. So this is the other thing that I'll just say before we take a break, which is I'm saying lots and lots of things here, and I'm saying it as like in a very like bossy way, like I know. And so I also just want to say anything that feels useful and like that in, as you practice it helps, take that. And anything that is irritating and you're like, no, absolutely not, except for one thing, which we'll get into next time, which is units, just leave it. It's not for you then, right? So I trust that you all know yourselves better than anyone else knows you, certainly than I know you. So these are just things that I say in this way because I do believe them, but they might not work for you. So, okay, last thing, and then we'll take a break. Yeah.
So like, this is all so wonderful and so helpful. I'm like sitting here thinking and trying to think through all things. What do I find helpful? And like, oh, but I don't have internet at home, so I need it in my space. But I also live in a really tiny boxy apartment, so that's not good either. So I was just wondering how long it took you to like figure out what worked. Was it just like a process of years and years and years, and just like trial and error consistently, or what was it?
Yeah, it was really for me a process and. For me, finding things that worked for me took a long time and also changes. It changes what works for me. So, right, like I've been being an academic writer for a long time. And I think that there's probably some ways that, you know, there's some things that are steady that I've found really work for me. So, like, I work in cafes very well. But, you know, my parents have been running a cafe since I was 8 years old, so there's probably reasons for why I feel like this is a wonderful, homey, fabulous place to be and work, right? Like, and then there are also certain things that I know have come into my life now, maybe also because of the way that technology has changed, right? That mean that it really is important for me to have it be not possible for me to open my email when I'm doing a unit of writing because of my sort of feeling that someone probably needs something that I should be relating to. Yeah. So I think it can take time and I also think it can change. Yeah. Okay, let's take 10 minutes and then we're gonna come back and have the like five commandments.